this evening, because our guest is brilliant, Abhijit Banerjee, economist, author, now Nobel Prize winner. He didn't have to win the Nobel Prize to be here, I can tell you that. He had enough fame by himself to be here and to get a full hall. And as if we didn't have enough, we have T.N. Nayanan, editorial chairman of Business Standard, the doyen of economic and business journalism in India. I used to be a reporter under him some time back in India Today, just about 3.5 decades back. So we go back a long time. So he will ask all the intelligent questions on the economy and the book. I will crack some jokes and maybe ask some questions about politics, because my life is about politics. So let me begin with politics. Are you left, right, or center?
I think I consider myself left in the sense that I believe... I'm sorry, I only have one voice and it's kind of cracked.
I'll try. We'll give you a hand mic.
I'll try with the hand mic. In the sense that I'm a believer in equality, a deep believer in equality, that people should have a right to, everybody should have the same right to flourish in a world. So if that means left, I'm a leftist.
So if that is how you define leftist, is Mr. Modi to the left of you, or about where you are, or a little on economics, or a little bit to the right of you?
I mean, sir, right now the position of the government is... I'm really sorry.
We are getting your microphone.
I'm waiting for my microphone, but I apologize.
Can you turn up the volume? This is his 106th interview since he came in. So
not quite, but is this better? Okay, Mr. Modi. Mr. Modi, I think he seems to have maybe more faith in the corporate sector than I do. I think this tax cut, recent tax cut, suggests that somebody in that administration believes in the message that you have to give corporate sector lots of money to get growth. I tend to not believe that. So,
Ninan?
Left in the traditional sense used to mean controlling the factors of production or the engines of production. Are you that kind of left, or are you welfare left, where you want to distribute?
Definitely welfare left. And in particular, I absolutely think that at this point, nobody's really saying, I mean, to the extent that, I mean, right and left are confused, India's under this so-called right-wing government is suddenly becoming more controlling, if anything. You see the trade liberalization being undone. So it's a, I think I'm going to leave that piece out.
This is red wrapped in saffron right now.
That's a nice color, actually. But it seems to me that what's critical in terms of what I would say left is a recognition that markets don't deliver a lot of welfare. And I think that's the at the heart of it is that idea that you need to go, you need to be, markets do lots of good things, but in the end, they don't deliver welfare. You do things to make them deliver welfare.
So if there is a trade-off between economic growth and equality or inequality, which side of that would you prefer to come down on? I want to frame it also in the context of what you say in your book, where you talk about the very rapid growth of China, and then you say the bottom 50% of the population, their share of total income dropped from 32 to 17. And if I were to put to you that while the share has dropped, if GDP is quadrupled, 17 is actually 68. So they've actually got much more money than they did before. So is that to you a worse outcome than wanting more equality?
Well, I would say that I want to resist the premise of that question. A part of what we do in the book is say there is no reason to think that you'd increase inequality to get growth. I don't think there is any demonstrated trade-off. I think if you look at the correlation between growth and inequality, we actually have a published paper where we do it. Basically, there is no correlation. So if anything, high inequality, if you look in the cross-section of countries, if you compare countries, more unequal countries grow slower. Now, that turns out, that's the core fact. Now, that would be the opposite of what you suggest. Now, it turns out that that's a little bit hard to interpret because the low inequality countries tend to be Denmark and the high inequality countries tend to be Brazil. They're not exactly similar. Now, once you look at what happens in a country like Brazil when inequality goes up or down, it has no correlation with growth. Inequality, you can increase, inequality can go up or down, it doesn't do anything for growth. It just does bad, inequality is bad, and it, when you get more inequality, you get more inequality. You don't get anything for it. So I think that question is part of we spend lots of time in our book arguing that that question is not one we need to deal with.
Okay.
So since I talked about Mr. Modi being to the left of you or not being to the left of you on economy, so before this, until these tax cuts, wasn't Mr. Modi doing what you asked governments to do? But he was doing it through indirect taxes. So crude prices went down, but he kept on upping excise, took those 12, 13 trillion extra rupees and used those for welfare, which won him the election. But now he tried to do it also through direct taxes and the market hit back and he panicked.
I don't think, as you said, anything I would disagree with. I think the direct taxes route is the better route. It's what every so developed economy does. China does it. You know, they just have much higher share of direct taxes in the budget than we have. And that's the way every country has gone. And we need to go there. And I think this was one of those. I was actually very happy in the budget when the taxes were raised. Because I've been saying for years that you have to raise taxes. You can't do have 9% deficit. If you take the aggregated deficit, it's something like 9%. That's just that's not a sustainable number. We have to do something about it. And I think there's something we have to do about it is raise taxes.
I think raising taxation at that level, the way the budget did, was the way to get more into the exchequer?
You know, the thing is that the tax rate remains actually 42-43% for individuals. And the correction in corporate tax is more an adjustment of incentives, and the effective rate of tax, there's no big change. So they haven't seriously undone what they did in the budget.
I think that it created a windfall for a bunch of companies. And that windfall was unnecessary. I don't think we're disagreeing on that. You're just saying maybe at the margin, for many companies, not much change. But for a set of companies which were quite profitable, it was a large windfall.
You reject the argument, actually, with the example of states in the U.S. that lower tax rates attract more investment. But if I were to put to you that, let's say, factories are leaving China, and they're going to Vietnam, where the tax rate for new factories coming in is 10%. And if your tax rate was 35%, why would they come here if they can go to Vietnam? You need to at least equalize to some degree.
I mean, 35%, then we tax dividend thrice over.
I think that what you pay for partly is what you get. You know, the the reason why we don't get it is not just that we tax people. We also don't spend it to provide good infrastructure. And the Chinese did enormous amount to, you know, you pay for it, you get something. If you pay for it and get nothing, I don't have to defend that particular
but
view.
Is but the high tax rate a disincentive?
I think mostly it's not. That's the evidence that I think the accumulation of evidence says that relative to most other things, like is there a demand for the commodity? Is there a good infrastructure available? It's not clear that high tax rates do very much. In fact, I mean, think of the U.S. in the 1950s and 60s. The U.S. has a marginal tax rate of 95% under Eisenhower, a Republican.
I think we've seen 97 or something.
Yeah, but they're all. Britain was also very high. He has it in his
budget. But this is and the U.S. has never grown faster than it grew in those years. It was the fastest ever growing years. It had tax rates between, you know, Nixon as a, you know, hard right guy is talking about 70% tax rates. Yeah. Like this is the world we've forgotten. We think somehow the new normal is 27%. That's high. This is just, it's sort of perverse. Now, I do think that there is some value to tax coordination, that in a sense, we're all shooting each other in our, well, we're shooting each other, ourselves in our own feet and each other as well.
That's actually the question. Can you, are you a rule taker or are you a rule setter? If the world has moved towards low taxation, can you, as a single country, fly against that trend?
Given how much of our, I think, investment pattern is driven by domestic demand, I'm not too worried about it. I think that we aren't, for a variety of reasons, we're not competitive with Vietnam. This is at the margin small.
So that brings me to something you said. I think I heard you say someplace on labor reforms. You said that a crisis should not, I'm implying that a crisis should not be wasted. So maybe this is a good time for this government with the majority and the prime minister having this great equity to push with labor reforms. That is not a left view. And what kind of labor reforms do you want?
So I think that the clear and obvious thing that needs to be done is to make the labor, the burden of firing somebody for sort of carried by society rather than the firm. So I think there should be reforms where, you know, firms are made to pay into a fund, like in many, most countries actually, which then pays the worker, whether or not you, once you fire the worker, he gets transitional payments from that fund. So that it's not the firm. What's happened in India is that we care about the worker getting unemployed. So we said, tell the firm, you carry him. But in fact, that's a social value we are providing, right? We care about him getting unemployed. So we should carry that. So I think the way it's done in most countries is by taxing firms and then using that fund. So it provides a form of insurance. Basically, if you happen to be unlucky, then you don't pay for all of that by having to hold on to those workers. That's the right way, and that form of insurance is efficient. So that's the right design for such a policy.
We did actually create a fund like that, not an across-the-board system, as you're suggesting, but using proceeds from privatization to help to retrain workers.
Right, exactly.
And then that got sabotaged in various ways.
Yes, but in a sense, we should do it at a much larger scale, much more systematically. That's the real... That's why I don't think this is a left-right issue. The left should support mobility of labor if the incomes are protected. I think what's the problem is we don't protect incomes. We just tell the firm, you protect his income. The firm then very cleverly finds ways to, you know, lock up, lock out, you know, find ways to get rid of workers in all kinds of creative ways. So in the end, it doesn't protect anybody. We should have a formal way of protecting workers. And
like a soft landing.
Yeah, soft landing. And that's what all well-designed...
Not protecting forever. I mean, not a pension forever.
Not protecting forever, but also, that's one part of it. But I'm also saying the firm doesn't protect, the system protects. So if I lose my job, the fund pays me for a while and gives me retraining money or whatever I need to transition. It should not be the liability alone of the firm that's used to hire, happened to have hired me. That's the distortion. The distortion is not that there should be some protection, but that the protection should not be borne by firms that happen to be unlucky.
You know, Piyush Goyal dismissed you as a left-leaning economist and all the rest of it. So my point is that if he actually read your book, he might find himself in agreement with what you say on trade. Because
Mr. Modi would.
Because this government has found that that free trade agreements have not worked well, and we are now therefore highly skeptical of getting into more such arrangements. And you actually argue that free trade does not necessarily always work, there are other conditions involved. Now, I think that's very much this government's position. So ironic thing that actually agree.
Even Nyay, they may be critical, but he actually preempted Nyay with PM Kisan.
Yeah. So let me say one thing on the trade, though. My view, and our view in this book, is very much that that we should not veer away from free trade, but that we should be cognizant of the fact that free trade is not free. It means some people get clobbered. And we know who those people are. And the economist's sleight of hand is to say, look, you know, resources are going to get reallocated. You know, capital will move. If some people lose their jobs and their wages are low, capital will move. Capital doesn't move. We know that. So therefore, where people lose jobs, they just stay clobbered for years and years and years. So I think the important point we were trying to make, that's maybe too pompous a way to say it, the point that we were trying to highlight is that it's very important to provide protection to the workers along with, you know, removing trade barriers.
Microphone there.
Shekhar, I can just make a quick point.
No, no, you need to speak on the microphone, sir. Tell us who you are so we can transcribe it, and he'll get the microphone to you in 1 second. We want you recorded for posterity.
Wonderful, thank you very much. Actually, as a lay person, non-economist, who happens
Please,
to
tell
be...
tell us your name and
my
what
name
you
is
do.
Vivek Kataria. I run an office automation and banking automation company. I was in the US for a few years, and as a non-economist, I'm delighted to see that commonsensical views that I've held for a while vis-a-vis taxes are being reflected by the exalted Nobel laureate here. And that is that, you know, there's a lot of emphasis on the collection of taxes and how to figure out how to catch people.
What is the question?
And the question is, I'm happy to pay my taxes if I can see something coming out of them. And the fact, I think that's a fantastic sort of statement made by Mr. Banerjee, which is that, you know, the quantum of taxes may not be the determining factor of incentive or disincentive. It's what's done with those taxes. So okay. I would like to suggest that maybe someone can nominate me for a Nobel Prize also for having exactly the same.
Sir, I think this is a rare occasion when two persons in a room over an issue of economics agree with each other. If we had only economists here, I won't be able to find two who agree. And economics is an argumentative science. It's a political argumentative science. So in fact, the next time, I think if we have to better this conversation, I have to get Jagdish Bhagwati on this side, him on the other, and we talk about trade.
Let's wait for them.
No, we'll make sure that you have a clear throat that day. Nail.
Since he mentioned Bhagwati, I want to bring up the issue that you're of course aware that some well-known economists, including Nobel laureates, have questioned the importance, if that's a word, of your entire work using random controlled experiments or tests. And they say that you've sort of left alone the larger questions of inequality and climate change, which of course you now have in this book. But I don't know if the book is a response to that criticism, where you're now tackling the bigger issues, or whether you reject that criticism completely.
I think I don't entirely reject that criticism. I think one of the biggest insights of economics is comparative advantage. I do what I'm good at. I don't prevent other people from doing what they want to do. That's point number one. Point number two is that I think there's a little bit of an illusion that because a question is important, it has an answer. And I think partly my personal instinct is I like questions I can answer. Some of these grand questions about, you know, is capitalism good or bad? Therefore, greater minds than me, I stay under there.
But you are now stepping into the role in some ways of a public intellectual. You're addressing a lot of questions.
You are
sort of becoming a second amateur Sen.
I want to be a public intellectual who's able to say, I don't know the answer to this question. I want to be, if there is one thing I want to claim, is the right to say, I know some things, but not everything, and I'm fine to pass this one.
So, because you made that point, that there are questions that you may not have an answer for, not everybody here is an economist. In fact, most of us here, including yours truly, are not economists. So explain to us in a couple of minutes, 1 minute, whatever time you want, what is RCT? Please hold forth.
So it's just the very, 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 very simple idea that if you want to know whether something works or not, a very credible way to do that is to say, I'm going to randomly give this to some locations or some people or some firms and not others. And then, because it's random, those groups are identical to start with, and then I see what happens. I see whether there's a difference as a result. That's a credible way to just look at whether there's an impact, and that's how we do drug. So give us one example. Okay, so to know whether microcredit works or not, before we did a randomized controlled trial, lots of people, especially who were in the microfinance business, were convinced that it was wonderful. And they were right in one way. What they saw was that the people who got microfinance were doing better than the ones that didn't get microfinance. Problem with that statement is that they would have been better even without microfinance. And that's what we show when we do the randomized controlled trial. We find that the people who got microfinance, who were offered microfinance, and the people who were not offered microfinance have identical economic outcomes. So that doesn't change. They might be happier, they might have bought more fridges, but they don't get richer. And that's the only way you can know that, it's precisely because the people who, if you offer it to somebody, not everybody takes it. Only the people who have some ambition and take it. So if I just look at somebody who has microfinance versus somebody who doesn't, I'm going to compare enterprising people with less enterprising people. That's the wrong comparison. We want to compare like with like. When we compare like with like, we find nothing.
Yeah. I'm Udit Bagga from Bagaling Group of Companies. We have interest in automobiles, restaurants, and a few more things. So I have two questions. One is... Okay. question one is, what do you think, how the government is doing on the expenditure part, like all the revenue what they get, how efficiently or inefficiently they are managing? Like you said, for the taxes, there was a contrary view for you, which I agree with. How is the government doing on the expense part? Like how the spendings, is it the right way, or what do you recommend? Is the right way forward?
I think the government, I think a bit through the set of choices the government has made, it has kind of slightly got into an awkward place. So that I think the commitment, for example, to having low inflation drove it to have, basically tamped down on support prices. Support prices, so the terms of trade, basically agricultural incomes went down relative to the rest of the country. This was the agricultural distress you heard about. Now, once you do that, then there's the next problem, which is farmers are unhappy. What do you do? Then you take some of the money from the fisc and you give it to PM Kisan. I think that's a bit painting yourself into a corner. I think we should have never made these very stringent commitments to low inflation in the first place, since it doesn't seem to be in our DNA.
So on that one, Dr. Manmohan Singh was right when he said this government's obsession with low inflation has caused farm distress.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, Dr. Manmohan Singh is an excellent economist.
And okay. How about selling the PSUs?
No.
Selling the PSUs for the current fiscal, to match the current fiscal deficit?
I said one question, but... It's a
good question, if I may.
Okay, yeah, please.
I mean, I think it would be, I think it, in the short run, it's a good idea, but it doesn't, selling the PSUs is not how we solve. It's, in a sense, it's just replacing one form of wealth with another. So it's not going to be a long-term solution. It's just, today I can sell it, but tomorrow I don't have it. So we have to worry about.
I think that's a good idea, because today you don't sell it, tomorrow you might not have it anyway.
Look at
BSNL, MTNL, yes, they all had value 10 years back.
I'm with you on that one.
Right.
But it could be a solution if change of ownership leads to more efficiency.
A large increase in value. Yeah, fair enough.
Which is usually the assumption.
I think the assumption, but I mean, I think at this point, many of these companies are pretty distressed. I don't know how much. Yeah. Who wants Air India?
Yeah, I know. So I want to switch track, if I may, and talk about the Nobel Prize. We've had something like half a dozen Indians working overseas win the prize in economics and in the sciences. Now, I can understand scientists working in a lab or having facilities there in, elsewhere, which we don't have in India. But for someone like you, most of your work is actually in India. So is it an advantage to be in MIT, or would you be able to do the same thing if you were based here? What is it that prevents people from here from doing what you do?
I think nothing prevents. I mean, we have people in many countries who do our cities. I think what MIT gave me was a bully pulpit to recruit students. I think I've had I think 100 PhD students who are professors at the leading institutions in the world, and that's what creates a movement. So I think that's a privilege which I don't think I would have had here. I think I've had the just remarkable set of PhD students, and they do what we do, and that's sort of the big benefit is just that. That's what I couldn't do in India.
You wouldn't be able to do that here?
Because I wouldn't get the world's supply of the best students coming. The world's supply of best students for many, many, many years have come to MIT.
I think they will take many years getting their visas cleared, even if they agree to come.
There's that.
My name is Vijay Khurana. I'm in the pharmaceutical business. You mentioned the randomized control trial.
That's trials. What you try to inform.
I just want to go back to it.
Yeah.
There's been some comments that it doesn't work all the time. Can you please elaborate on that? Because there's been some criticism of that not being the panacea for not being the solution for every problem.
Well, there are two separate points. One is, I don't want the government of India to randomize monetary policy. So there's some questions you don't want to answer in doing that. I mean, sometimes it might look like it's doing that, but it shouldn't be. That's point number one. Point number two is that it always has the problem of essentially all empirical knowledge, that if I study this problem in India, does it apply to Indonesia? And that's a problem not just of randomized control trials, it's a problem of all empirical knowledge. Indeed, David Hume, the Scottish philosopher, pointed out in 17-something that it's a problem with our lives. Every morning when we wake up, we decide that when I walk out of the door, I'm not going to fall through the ground. And the reason is not because I've proved that that's true. There's no empirical proof that the world is stable. It's just an assumption. So in that sense, you're always dealing with that. And to be honest, sometimes we do one randomized controlled trial, we find something, the next time we don't find it, and you have that in the pharmaceutical industry as well. You have to, you know, every trial, every population is different. Sometimes you discover ex post that the population you did it the first time was the ideal population, and if you do it with anybody else, it doesn't work. So those are things you have to take into account, and you have to do them. There's no way to cheat.
When you make a sample size and when you do the protocols, you then prepare the protocols to be comparative to whatever control that you're doing.
I think you should buy a copy of the book.
You'll
find many of the answers there. So before we come to the next question, political question for me. You've been saying that you are not neutral, you are deeply ideological. You said you are left, welfare left, that's fine. But are you also ideological politically? And where would that place you in American politics and in Indian politics?
So I think, let me give you a slightly complicated answer. Because I feel like part of the problem in the conversation in India is that the role of a professional is undervalued. I feel like first, I'm a professional, like a surgeon. It doesn't matter who's on the table, I'm operating. So, and I really believe that. My first commitment is to being right. And we, as a result, when we work, We work with state governments across the political spectrum. We work with Mr. Modi in Gujarat when he was chief minister. We worked with Mamata Banerjee in West Bengal, and you can take the everybody in between as well.
Which one was more fun?
I reserve the right to not answer some questions. I think that's part of the answer. Part of the answer is I'm not ideological in terms of my professionalism. I think professionalism is my ideology. I want to be first right and try to be as right as possible. Then there are, of course, on specific, you know, social issues, I might have views which may be clear.
So in terms of those issues, social and political issues, where would we place you in American politics? You are an American voter now. And where would we place you in Indian politics? Because you are an Indian.
So in American politics, I'm a left Democrat, I would say.
But left Democrats have a wide range from Biden to...
I don't consider left. Elizabeth Warren seems to me to be in my sweet spot right now. That may be awkward to use of words, but yes, something like that.
Everybody knows how Donald Trump addresses her.
And in Indian politics, I think I would be also left of center. And what party I would vote for is a question, because it's often not obvious who represents the left of center in India. And so it will depend on where I'm voting.
Because next election will not be in JNU. Next national election will not be in JNU. So who do you vote for if you want to vote left?
That's a good question. I'm not saying I'm not troubled by it, but I am saying that I, you know, if you ask me who I am as a human being, I'm sort of, I see myself as being that much reviled term, liberal.
So in terms of your political growing up years, that was the 80s, early to late 80s when you left. That is when we just had the riots in Delhi, Mrs. Gandhi's assassination, et cetera, et cetera. How did all that mold your politics?
You know, in some sense, I think I was already pretty formed. By the early 80s, I was pretty formed. I tend to be very opinionated, and so, I mean, I think I already kind of knew where I was, and I didn't particularly have much sympathy for the traditional left, and I didn't have much sympathy for the traditional right, so I was already lost at some level. I'm still lost.
So you talked about being a professional more than anything else, and you begin the book by talking about how ordinary people have a certain view of an economic issue, and the experts have a different view. And even if you present the views of the experts to the first group, they don't particularly change their position. So from that sort of minimalist position, you towards the end of the book, you come to talking about the power of ideas. So what is the impact that you think your book will actually have, given that you have both these realities?
So God willing, I always emphasize the power of prayer in all in the talks I give. So, God willing, what we're trying to do is exactly bridge one gap we think we've identified, which is that economists speak mostly as oracles. They say, they say 7.6% growth. How do you know? It's like, come on, you have to be
kidding. Nobody checks when they go
wrong. Yeah, you have to be kidding. Okay, but like people pronounce, they pretend to know more than they do. What we're trying to do in this book is partly to expose our ignorance, partly to expose the process of knowing, to recruit people into the belief that there is actually some systematic knowledge out there. You have to be patient. It's not easy to get. You can make mistakes, but at least we have a chance of learning. That's the point of view we are trying to sell in this book. That learning is possible, that learning is not automatic, that it's often hard work to know the answer to questions, and don't trust anybody who tells you that growth will be 7.63%. I think that's one of the...
It's like the fund managers tell you S&P at this much by this month, or Sensex at this much by this month. And nobody checks back. Yogendra, please stand up and please stand up and ask. So Yogendra Yadav, and they were not just classmates, they were also in Tihar jail together. which also confirms to us the fact that it isn't just the Modi government, but Congress governments have also been putting JNU students in jail. So the fault,
right.
So the fault must lie with JNU, with people like you and him.
Or just us. 300 of us, and for 14 days. Abhijit, the conversation so far has highlighted your differences with the right free market, free trade kind of economics. I wanted to ask you something which enables you to highlight the other bit, your differences with the orthodox left, which has been equally critical. And I think it's good news. It's equally critical of what you've done, your use of your being open to using market instruments, you're moving away from state instrumentalities in each case. So would you wish to say something about that? What is it that differentiates you from traditional left?
So I think I have maybe substantially less faith in governments, I would say. I think anybody who's realistic and looks at the, you know, the policies and the implementation of policies that in India you have to start by worrying that, you know, what the government says will happen doesn't always happen. So it's not that I usually believe that for most things there is, with a perfect government which runs perfectly, you can improve on the market outcome. It's just that the government is so strapped for perfection that, you know, we have to let off a lot of things. The government should pick the most important things and do them, because it can only do a few things well at best. And so, and then the rest, the market is never perfect, but at least it's better than a government doing its job very badly.
Microphone to her. That's about sixth row, the lady.
Good evening, Dr. Banerjee.
I can't have this male domination go on.
I'm Mansi Jain. I'm an advocate in Supreme Court of India. I wanted to congratulate you and congratulate Dr. Esther for becoming the youngest recipient of this honored prize. I also wanted to mention that you have written in your book that overwhelming problems can be broken down into objectives and resources can be used on those objectives. I wanted to ask which objective in eradication of poverty in India is closest to your heart and in Dr. Esther's heart?
So I think that if I had to pick one thing, I would say improving the quality of education that most people get. That's the one that I would say is my instinctively the one I most worry about. I think she might as well have the same view. It's not entirely accidental that we're married.
Mr. S.Y. Qureshi, he's a former Chief Election Commissioner and former IAB Secretary and Health.
DG Doordarshan.
Yes.
Yeah. Shekhar, since you don't allow two questions, I'm going to ask one and a half.
Sir, you are on my wedding pictures from 40 years ago. So you can ask three.
Yes. Thank you so much. Since JNU has been mentioned, how do you see the role of JNU in shaping you, and how do you see its future?
So I'm going to leave the future to wiser people. On me, it was extraordinarily important. I came from a world of, you know, I went to Presidency College in Kolkata. In Presidency College is a fine, extremely committedly left-wing institution. It had nobody who was not an upper caste Bengali. It was middle class, upper caste Bengalis were the only people I knew. I mean, maybe I knew a few others, but some rich, some not rich, but mostly I lived among upper caste Bengalis. Come to JNU, I encountered India. There's caste, there is real poverty,
these things were not actually real for you if you live in the world I lived in. So I think JNU taught me all about what India is.
You have a second question?
Good evening. I'm Dr. Vivek Gupta, and of course, hearty, profusely congratulations to...
He's a well-known cardiologist.
I'm a cardiologist by profession in Apollo Hospital, New Delhi.
Thank you.
And of course, the friend of Print, and I'm thankful to Print to get you, because I have met many Nobel laureate but never have been able to ask a question. So I have
to... Maybe you'll be disappointed.
So actually, I have been trained in France, and your wife is from France. That made me further happy. My question would be a little off the way, not economy, because economy is not my subject. I cannot ask good questions. We have one top cardiologist in France, and I have been trying to nominate him. My society and my function. So is it, first question would be, just, did you come to know about your coming, getting the Nobel on the same day as we knew? And what is the other method that we can, he's done a lot of innovations. Professor Alain Cribier from France.
I don't know how one nominates. Try a little bit. So I think one of the things our research shows is that, I mean, I think people sort of, I think what it does is gives a little texture to the nature of what the problem is in public sector banks. Part of the problem in public sector banks is decision making is absolutely frozen. So people, the first order fact is that from year to year, the amount of loan given to any borrower doesn't change. You try to not take decisions. We have data from when, you know, the nominal growth rate in India is like 12%, okay? But 66% of the firms get zero change in their loan, even though they're hitting their credit limit all the time. That's a sign of a system that's not very responsive. And I think that the key problem with public sector banks is, I think, taking a decision is something that people like to avoid. Partly, we also find that's a result of this fact that public sector banks are, if a loan goes bad in a public sector bank, the Central Vigilance Commission has the right to investigate it. That would scare many people.
You mentioned the least scary of the three-letter words in this city. CBI comes first.
Nonetheless, I think if CVC was breathing down your neck, you wouldn't take decisions. So what happens as a result is people try to not take decisions. And when they take decisions, it's usually to bail out some firms so that they don't have to declare a bankruptcy. So you get a lot of evergreening as a result of that, because they're all scared that, you know, there'll be a default. And then Abhijit was on that loan file, so Abhijit gets the CVC. So Abhijit, what he does, he calls up the bank and says, well, I'll give you a bigger loan, you pretend to pay me back, and then we are good for another few years. I think this is a very distorted incentive system.
That's precisely the DHFL PMC case. The lady right at the back, 8th row? 8, yes. If you stand up, microphone will come to you. Oh, okay. It'll come to you. Go ahead. Yes.
Good evening, Dr. Banerjee. My name is Gurmeet Singh Chuk. I represent a company. I have a company, Translumina, which manufactures devices for heart attack. Now, whatever little economics I studied during in the school, we realized that health has remained a very strong pillar for the welfare of the state and also for socialism. And where we have a scheme where the government is embarking to reimburse the health for almost 500 million people.
Ayushman Bharat, you mean?
Yeah, Ayushman Bharat. So on one side, it looks, it could be a political agenda, but on the other side, I mean, a scheme where so many people are getting insured, from an economist view, where nobody's paying the premium. Typically, in most of the countries worldwide, people pay even little premiums to get an insurance. Here, nobody's paying the premiums. Do you see this is practical, or will it only remain more like a political move?
Yeah, I think it's... I don't see why, if the political demand is there, why it won't be practical. I think it's a matter... Because in the end... Even in the US, low-income people, you know, get health care which they don't pay for. So I think it, in principle, I don't think this is a huge, huge, I don't think there is a huge conceptual problem. I think there are two problems. So I like the idea of Ayushman Bharat. I think it provides something very necessary, which is basically when people need to spend lots of money on healthcare, they often end up being, you know, losing all their assets. And that it prevents that, and that's a good thing. It doesn't do two things. One, it should not be thought of as an innovation that's going to fix health. People's health is usually fixed by kind of smaller, you know, early detection, early treatment, not, you know, making operations cheaper. So that's first order. It's not going to fix health, so it should be important. Second is, I think there's huge sort of potential for fraud in this scheme. And I think that's the thing that needs to be fixed. And it's not an easy thing to fix. I think the previous, you know, the RSBY in Rajasthan had to be shut down because there was so much fraud. So I think that there's lots of things to worry about in this scheme. I do think it's a good challenge to take up because it has good welfare consequences. But it's expensive and it needs to be done well.
So if Mr. Modi were to visit you in Boston, what food would you cook for him?
Excellent. I like cooking, you know, what in Bengali is called widow's cuisine, which is vegetarian food which doesn't use garlic and ginger and onions. It's based on an extraordinarily oppressive theory, which is that if widows eat onions, their sexual desires will be raised, and therefore let's keep them away from it. Nonetheless, it's a wonderful cuisine. It's very delicate. It's extremely kind of fine flavors, using vegetables in imaginative ways. So I'll cook widow's cuisine. No implication about widowhood there. I eat it.
On immigration, you have a chapter in the book, and you broadly argue that all the arguments, economic arguments against immigration, don't basically hold. And it seems to run fundamentally counter to the move here on the National Register of Citizens. So would you comment on this whole NRC thing?
Yeah, I want to just say that I think there are many issues with NRC, how it will be implemented, etc. Let me not go into those. Just as an economic idea, I feel like when we can steal the top talent of other countries, because most immigrants tend to be selected positively. So you want to steal the top talent of every country if you can. We're getting to steal the top talent of Bangladesh, which is thank you very much. I think that is really immigration. Most people don't immigrate because they're scared. The people who do immigrate tend to be enterprising people. Enterprising people is the lifeblood of an economy. We should be grateful that we're getting some. We should try to see if some other countries will send us some bright people.
Hello? Can you hear me?
No. Is it working? Just fix a microphone, somebody. It's working.
Trying to understand is how can these findings really be incorporated into policy?
I have the disadvantage of being old. So I remember a time when you went to somebody and said, this is the result of an RCT. And they said, what are you talking about? Then you explain it and they say, are you crazy? Now they know what an RCT is mostly. And they are often, they'll hear you out. Sometimes that means it translates into policy. It's actually remarkable how many times it does translate into policy, in my view, given that no policy changes. Even when you don't provide evidence, policies tend to be very sticky. So I don't think you should take the view that the default is I go to Minister X and I give him my RCT and he says, okay, gee, I'm going to change everything tomorrow. That's not my presumption about the political system. My presumption of the political system is that mostly change is difficult, even with and without RCTs. In fact, we actually get a lot of purchase from, partly from having our cities, partly from the process of doing our cities, which is you can't do our cities in a day. It takes a long time to do them. You embed yourself in systems. You actually become very knowledgeable. And often what people are impressed by in government is the fact that you actually know many details that they don't know. And then they take you a little bit seriously.
You said that you don't, sorry. Okay. No, go ahead, please.
My name is Talbir Singh. I'm Secretary of the Congress Party. I have a question for Mr. Banerjee. It's on poverty alleviation. We still bear nearly 23% of the global poverty burden. And poverty has many dimensions, economic, social, gender, even public health, education, everything indirectly related to poverty alleviation. We are, at some level, we are very fortunate. We have one of the best constitutionally mandated local governments in the country. We have nearly 250,000 urban and local bodies in the urban as well as rural areas. Many governments have local bodies, but they're not constitutionally mandated like Australia. And at another level, in the last few decades, our decision-making, our policies have been too centralized. We conceive all centrally sponsored schemes, not the central in the federal government. I'm asking him that for poverty alleviation, don't you think it'll be a better deal if we delegated many of the responsibilities to the local governments, to Panchayati Raj institutions? They are anyway mandated to carry on many of these functions, including poverty alleviation. And even functions like primary health care, primary education are one of the important functions of Panchayati Raj institution.
I think he's got it.
So I've actually spent some time thinking about it. I think the problem is that having worked with many panchayats on various, I would say the manpower, we have to then create a system by which the manpower in the panchayats is supplied somehow. Most panchayats in China, every village is sent 10 young graduates to work in the village. We have often in our entire government, we have no graduates. So I think we need, if we want them to do more, we need to also create a situation where they have the human capital to do it. And I think we need to think this through. So I think if we just take schemes and dump them, I mean, many of the schemes are actually, like in Narega, one scheme that do, you see some, you know, some people implement it, others just don't implement it. They're just scared by the complexity. You have to scan something and put it, you know, put up the muster rolls. How do you scan something? So they get scared. So I think you can't simply mandate governance. You have to actually create the conditions under which it's possible.
Abhijit, if I may caution you, graduation and degrees are a very sensitive issue in Latians Delhi.
I will. I did that. I didn't say it.
Most people on the left would actually want governments to do more. But you've just said that you are skeptical about the government and the stuff it does. At the same time, you're working very closely with state governments. So presumably, you're seeing some positive results from your engagement with state governments. So I'm not quite clear where exactly you stand on governments and...
My view is that governments have a huge challenge. It's very difficult. What they do is, in a sense, chosen. That's one argument we make in the book. Governments do things which are difficult to do because markets are actually easier to run. Governments choose things. If they choose right, they choose things that the markets don't do. And then you have to do things like, I mean, it's easy to sell an apple, or relatively easy. I couldn't do it, but somebody could. Whereas, you know, when you want to allocate something like healthcare, but you don't want to give it to the highest bidder, now you have a real problem because you don't know who to give it to. Everybody says, you know, mujhe de do, but, you know, who do you give it to? So that's what makes governments have a very difficult job to do. So my view is, therefore, when governments do it, they need help. It's not easy to do. It's easy to screw it up. And they sometimes do, sometimes don't. But I see my role as supporting governments. Not because governments are the only actor in the space, but because they have often a very difficult job. And in that job,
some know-how I have might be useful.
Do you see any role for civil society in keeping government straight?
Absolutely. I mean, we've also actually done research on this. We've done a bunch of stuff on, for example, we did an experiment in Delhi where we told corporators that 2 years hence, a report card on you will be published in the newspaper. This is Delhi Corporation. And performance improves and all kinds of, they start doing more for the people, the citizens living in their areas. So I absolutely think that media and institutions like that are vital for me.
It depends on which newspaper you go to. Some odd one will give you a rate card.
This was in Hindustan.
Good evening, Dr. Banerjee. I'm Aarti. Yeah, I'm Aarti Gupta. I'm an economist turned VC. My question is, what is your opinion on welfare, in particular, farm loan waivers being used as a political tool?
So I think that farm loan waivers are what happens when you don't have a good machinery for transferring resources to people you will transfer resources to very quickly. Farm loan waivers is a very efficient way to do that, meaning you can. It has lots of bad consequences. It kind of creates, it squeers the credit market, but it's quick. I can say in 1 day, your loan is waived. It's inequitable. It's often extremely, it creates bad incentives, but it's quick. So I think we need to replace the existing mechanisms for more efficient mechanisms for making transfers. When the government wants to make farmers happier, it shouldn't need to do a farm loan waiver. It should be able to send them money or something, much less distortionary.
Harsh, you have the microphone. So yeah. Harsh runs, I'm being mischievous. Harsh is my neighbor. He also runs Delhi's most, I would say the best, imaging center. And I'm being mischievous because my joke with him is that when I really want to know what's going on, every important person's heart and mind, I have to hack into his computers and get the scans out. Harsh.
Congratulations, Dr. Banerjee. Harsh Mahajan. I'm a radiologist, and we have been working in the field of artificial intelligence since about 2 years in specifically imaging. And our feeling is that we will be able to somehow lower costs and be able to access areas where radiologists may not be available. What is your take on this, and how quickly do you think this is going to come into the mainframe?
You know far more about this than I do. As a part of my commitment to not shooting my mouth on everything, I'm going to pass on this one.
Mr. Agarwal, see, the print is a big white tent of opinion, and that's why we are able to attract participants from all sides. So here is a gentleman, Mr. Gopal Krishna Agarwal. He is one of the key members of the BJP's economic think tank.
Sir, I read that government should invest more, spend more, and then fiscal deficit is one of the target that government can look into expansionary policies on the fiscal side.
I said right now, not in the long run, but if the economy is going down, this is the time to spend more.
Yeah, and fiscal deficit can be ignored or expansionary policies can be followed.
Yes.
I want your take on what will be its effect on FDI and the credit rating agency that the globally do on the funds flow. That's an important concern that has to be.
I think it will be good for FDI because a lot of FDI in India is Indian market focused. So if Indian market actually does well, that attracts FDI. When Indian market slumps, that FDI goes down. So India is not one of the places where FDI is done in order to export. So in that sense, I think if the market is, if India is prosperous, if the growth is high, FDI will come in. I don't worry about that. I think on the question of the credit rating, I do think that this is, I think our credit rating is nuts. We've never come close to defaulting. Why are we giving these kind of junk bondish ratings. I think it's completely unfair. And I think these international agencies...
So India deserves better ratings than it's getting right now.
Yeah. I mean, when have we come even close to defaulting?
I mean, do you want this?
No, no, I want to ask something else, which is, you know, you point out that there was a certain period of very rapid economic growth globally, and it built up, and then post-World War II for about 3 decades, and it's been different stories since then.
In the West? So, in the West? I mean, Chinese growth happened after that.
But globally now, growth is slower than it has been for some time. Or are you still up? No, so let me ask the question, which is, do you think India has come too late to the party?
It's an excellent question. I don't know the answer to that question, but it's a very worrying thought. It's one thought that maybe there was a point where, for example, when Chinese garment industry was kind of hitting the boundaries and Bangladesh and Vietnam were stepping in, maybe we were the country which had a size restriction on what could be in the garment sector. So we didn't take that particular opportunity, and now it might be too late. That was one of the great manufacturing make or break opportunities, and we didn't take it.
So it's like missing the
general sense of labor intensive manufacturing sort of being less important as you go along because of automation. And so on.
But maybe that's that. If you're right, then we don't worry about it. I'm a bit worried we may not be right.
Yeah. So it's like missing the ramp onto the highway.
Correct.
And getting caught in traffic.
Yes. So I think we may have got caught in the traffic.
Sir, you and then. I stood up because, you know, it's a bit dark in the back. So if there are questions in the back, please stand up. Yes. We'll get the microphone to you. And anybody else, and those who are standing can also ask. Yes, microphone will come to yours. Anirudh, you too.
I am Prem Sevak Sudhish, from a faculty member in the Albag Educational Institute in Agra. Professor Banerjee, much in your book and your work resonates with what we've been doing in the Albag for over 100 years in alleviating misery of the marginalized population through an experimental approach. So my specific question to you is what, in your view, is the best way to make models that have been successful in certain communities replicate and scale up globally?
I don't know the best way. I think models that are, I think you know better the answer to the question. I think making models that are scalable is important. And I think you already mentioned that you're doing scalable models. So I don't have any particular wisdom to add to that.
Right here, in the okay, ma'am, you, and then in the second row, Mehadena, the lady here.
I'm Pami Dua from the Delhi School of Economics. I congratulate you on your stellar achievement, as well as the experimental approach that you have advocated and employed successfully. Now, I am associated with the university in Dalbagh in various ways, and what I want to say is that is a living socio-economic model of community and education engagement. And I feel that this model comes very much close to your work and is very aligned with your philosophy. And it is just a thought that perhaps we can talk about this, have a dialogue between the approach that is used in education and also the approach that comes very close to your heart in alleviation of poverty and upliftment of marginalized sections of the society.
As you know, I'm very, very willing to come and learn. I just haven't had a chance right now. Thank you.
Amira?
Thanks, Shekhar. Congratulations. Quick question. My name is Amira Shah. I'm a healthcare entrepreneur. Private
Metropolis Labs, which is one of India's largest path lab networks.
We've obviously seen private investment dry up the last 7-8 years completely. But with the kind of fear that there continues to be today amongst industrialists, entrepreneurs of organizations, what are the 3 things the government should be doing to actually spur private investment?
you may know more than me, but I mean, from people like you, I've heard that the government should let bureaucrats take decisions and not double guess them. I think that's one thing that I keep hearing, is that people don't want to take decisions because they feel that they'll be, you know, they'll be maybe reviewed by somebody else and then they will be put in a bad light. So I think it's very important to let people make mistakes. I think one of the things we have to absorb in our governance is that making mistakes is the nature of decision making. If we want to have perfect 2020 hindsight, the best way to achieve that is to take do nothing. I think I'll give you 3 points. One point is, I think we need to encourage people to do things, make mistakes, not accuse them of malfeasance when they make mistakes. Mistakes are mistakes, not malfeasance.
Abhijit, before the gentleman at the back asks a question, let me ask you a planted question. And I'll make full disclosure, I will also tell you who planted it on me. Shiki, that's your dad. Avik planted the question on me last evening. So you blame him, not me. You've been saying in your interviews that you are not a macroeconomist. So Avik said, ask Abhijit. All these guys keep saying, I'm not a macroeconomist, I'm not a macroeconomist, yet they give all solutions on macroeconomy.
So if you read many of the interviews I've given, one thing I am very chary of is, one thing I try to emphasize a lot is that I'm really an amateur, and that when I'm trying to triangulate the facts that other people present to me, in some ways I'm not a macroeconomist means that, you know, if there is a subtle nuance in something, I might miss it. All I'm doing is, after that, I'm an economist, I'm trained to be a kind of to read the facts as they are. You present me the fact that investment is falling and and average consumption in NSS is not growing, and I'm reasonably willing to conclusion that growth is probably slowing. It doesn't take a huge amount of wisdom, but you're right. I sometimes step past my competence, and fair enough.
I'm done.
Gentleman in the back, right?
Yes.
Yeah,
there are lots of people in the back.
Yep. So my name is Preet Singh. I'm in the automotive industry, and I think all of us read newspapers. We know what's happening to the industry. We've had about 30 to 40% downfall in revenue over the last 8 months. This is, of course, one of the things, but overall in the country, we've seen a slowdown in the last 1 year, which is unprecedented. My question is, is this linked to what's happening all over the world? You've got the European zone slowing down. You've got recession almost in France and Germany. Or is this really a local issue which is specific to policy decisions by the government in India? If you were at the helm of affairs, would there be some steps the government could take that you could recommend to reverse this cycle?
So let me answer. Since I've answered the second part of the question a couple of times already, let me answer the first part, which is, I think that if you look at the slowdown, especially in investment, it happens way before any global slowdown happens. I think the globals, it predicts the slowdown rather than is predicted by the slowdown. I don't think it's the global slowdown that's driving it.
Who has the microphone now? You've been raising your hand for a long time in that corner. Now, preference for standees. And now people from the print can also ask questions. Yes.
Hi, my name is Dwani Agnaraman. I work with the Busara Center for Behavioral Economics.
Yes.
And I used to work for Evidence for Policy Design, so I know a lot about RCTs. First of all, congratulations on your
Thank
Nobel.
You.
I wanted to know what were your hopes and fears for the field of development economics going forwards. And I know I'm not supposed to ask two questions, but I have another really good one. What do you think has changed since you wrote Poor Economics and now in the time between your two books? Thank you.
Let me answer the first question, since So I guess my hopes is that it's going to attract a bunch more. I mean, I think I said this to Ninan before. The great excitement of my life is attracting great students into the field. And I hope this will attract more great students into the field. That's what makes my life interesting.
May I?
Yeah, sure.
My name is Harish Seth, and I'm sort of retired from business now. Just do golf. First of all, congratulations.
Thank you.
And may I suggest you please hold the mic in your right hand, because then everybody can hear you when you're talking to them.
Okay.
My, we've been talking of a lot of things here, but I tell you, there is a fundamental change that is going on in the country, and a lot of things that are coming out, whether it is the slowdown, whether it's the NPAs, or whether it is the fiscal policy, is the result of politics. I think we all have to, you have spoken about labor reforms, you talk about land reforms. This is such a complicated issue, you know, you don't know where to start. I commend you for what you have opinions on, but my question is, this country is not comparable at all to Trump's country. What is your take on that? How can you compare a country like India to a Western developed country and accept norms or things that you have established there to work in this country? This country works in a different way.
I think you can read my book. I don't think I say anything like that. I'm going to not defend.
Sir, in our
this.
Country, at least our Prime Minister Modi knows the name of his defense minister.
Yeah.
Question right there. He made him Esperanto yesterday. Poor Esper. Question right there.
Hello. This side here?
Yes.
Okay. I'm Mrs. Vasudeva, and I was an entrepreneur. Now I've sort of scaled down my work. This side here. I want to ask you, what is your view for entrepreneurs? I mean, the whole conversation here is in a loop about this side here, sir. It's in a loop that, you know, here's the money, let's take it and put it in this project or that project, based on the premise or the presumption that there is money and somebody's made that money. So if after 20 years you build up a business, then does that entrepreneur have any right to the money that that entrepreneur has created? I have a huge uneasy, feeling about this, that the conversation all the time is, take the money and put it there. So where's the money come from?
I think that, I guess all due respect, let me say that I suspect that if you're in this room, you're not probably in the bottom 1%. So I don't think that you are not, you didn't keep any of the money. I'm going to not push that point any further.
Anirudh, please stand up and introduce yourself.
Good evening. Congratulations, Professor Banerjee. I'm Anirudh Taparia from Indian Infoline. Well, my question is, while I'm an economics student, but my question I'm going to ask a little bit about more about what I face at home, especially when you have the millennials so-called at home asking a lot of questions about economics from that perspective. We have heard a lot about left, right, equality, non-equality, right? And then a lot of times a debate happens about people paying tax and a lot of people subsidizing for it. How do we look at the sentinels or millennials asking us about meritocracy out here with inequality and equality kind of stuff? So how does meritocracy really come out here?
Meritocracy is the fact that
two questions there, then we'll close, I think.
Is the fact that people who produce more earn more. It's not the statement that the people who produce more earn 50 times more. A meritocracy is about having the right direction, not about the level. Except that often means that some other people have to be bailed out by somebody else.
Well, if you read the book, you will find many such instances. For example, even the instance of the mill lands in Bombay, where many of you work. You know, when mill lands got gentrified, people who were more prepared to benefit from it, benefited from it. whereas people who left the Midlands did not quite get very much. So a lot of that discussion is there. Please do buy and read the book. We'll take the last two questions. And if we have one from, yes, sir. Nipun first.
Good afternoon. Good evening, sir. I'm Nipun Malhotra. And sir, I'm here.
Right here, in the corner, front row.
Hi, I'm Nipun Malhotra. I'm a disability rights activist. So you spoke a lot about liberalism and the left, but it's kind of become politically irrelevant in today's day and age. So how do you see it becoming politically relevant again?
With the left?
I guess I believe that it is so important that we can't let go of it. If it's become irrelevant, if we let go of it, it will become irrelevant. I do think that it's vital that we stand up for our traditions to defend the right to to dissent. I think that's extremely important value.
So the last two questions, and if we have any question from the print, I'll take it. Otherwise, I have to now wind up.
Well, I'm Sanjeev Sen, senior advocate in the Supreme Court. Well, firstly, we are extremely proud of your achievement.
Thank you.
My question is, India is passing through a very critical stage of its history and beset by various problems. So if offered, would you accept spending more time to sort out the various problems which are facing us?
I mean, depends what more means. I spent a fair amount of time here, and more than many people who actually live here. And so, that's a joke, but it's not, sometimes my children think it's not a joke. I do think that, yes, surely, I mean, I do feel that, as I said, my goal in life is to be a professional who does what he's trained to do. And if I can do something useful, I'll do it.
Good evening, Mr. Banerjee. My name is Akshay Taneja, and I run a real estate firm in the capital. I have a question for you about the economy, how a decision of the government is affecting the economy. So there's a rule that is binding all the companies in India that if a company owes $1,500 or 1 lakh rupees to an operational creditor, that organization can take that company into insolvency. Do you feel that is in any way good or bad for the economy?
Within 30 days.
Within 30 days, yes.
That sounds a little trigger happy to me.
So I'll take that as a no.
I guess.
Okay. Thank you.
So I think with left side.
I think the gentleman at the back had his
hand. At the back, yes. You've been waiting. That's the last question, and then Ike. Okay, Ike. We'll have a question. We'll have the microphone come.
Yeah, good evening, gentlemen. My name is Anil Chopra. We market a SaaS product, which is into website optimization, A-B testing to be precise. So my question is with regard to this RD trials. So do you find any similarity with A-B testing? Because the A-B testing has already proven correct and is a world standard now to test the hypothesis that whether A is right or whether B is right.
So it's closely related to A-B testing.
That is great. And the second question is with regard to economy.
Not second question.
Just a quick question.
Not allowed.
Do you agree, Mr. Banerjee, do you agree that corruption is good for economy?
I'm going to not answer, I think.
I think the people I'm having to say no to. Ike only gets a question because he's from Meghalaya. He's from Shillong. I can't say no to somebody from Northeast.
Yes. Thank you so much, Mr. Shekhar. Congratulations,
thank you,
Mr. Banerjee, for winning the Nobel Prize. My question is, the Indian housewife, at every level, they are the best economists, homemakers. What can economists and other professionals already sitting here can guide the government of the day? Because their job is only governance and legislation. They are doing everything else other than these two. So how can a Nobel laureate like you, who is doing so much in India, sir, get into together with all professionals to guide the government of the day to run with good economy at the grassroots level, empowering women?
I think it's the opposite with women among the Khasis in your home state.
Right? Yes, please. So, is pan-India, how do you make every family happy with the right economy, with other professionals? You are already sitting here. Why can't they be one compact professionals of every trade guiding the government?
So I want to end on a, I think it's, I tend to have the, maybe the same slightly technocratic view that you have, which is that I think there is a fair amount of knowledge that's available. We don't use it, we should use it more. I agree with that sentiment. Thank you.
Well, I think we have to bring this to an end. And Ninan, you want to have a last word? You're done. So thank you very much, Abhijit. I'll misuse my position as the moderator and make mention one takeaway, one observation, and one disclosure. So the takeaway is that nationalism and scholarship don't go together. So countries that where scholarship prosper are the ones that allow scholars from everywhere to come there. You cannot define scholarship in nationalistic terms.
That I would say that's just the wrong definition of nationalism. Yeah.
So that's what I took away from your saying that one thing that you get there is all the scholars from all over the world. That's one. Number two is the observation. Observation is that I know many large communities, large and prosperous communities, that follow the kind of diet quite firmly that you mentioned, minus onion, minus garlic. I do not believe it interferes with their hormones or libido in any way. Right?
I think that's the Bengali view that, you know, these, it's to justify the men eating all the fish and the meat. That's why they have projected this myth.
And third thing, I said the disclosure. The disclosure is that on many of these arguments on political economy, I'm on the side exactly the opposite of yours. But I'm very happy that you are talking, because I'm quite sure that all the prescriptions you now gave, all the advice you give, Modi Sarkar will do exactly the opposite of it.
Excellent. So you get your job.
Very happy.
Congratulations.
So thank you very much for watching. As we promised you, this has turned out to be one of our best sessions of Off the Cuff. So thank you, Ninan.
Thank you.
Thank you, Abhijit. And thank you, this marvelous, marvelous audience.